In the studio with me is one member of our community that's stepping up, and he's going to be running for council, and that is Mr. Peter Humphreys, a.k.a. Bordy. Good morning, Peter.
Good morning, Sean. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing good. Thanks for coming in to talk a little bit about why you threw your name into the ring. So with that said, why, after all this time, you've decided to throw your name into the hat?
Sean, I couldn't sit on the sidelines anymore. It was a tough decision. You know what the toughest part is? Is I was thinking about running, and I was looking at the list of candidates when it was coming out. And that first week, I only saw that one name on there. Cody jumped in there and really worried, because there was one person there that I couldn't beat, that I was waiting to see if that name came up. And if that name came up, I wasn't running. I was really worried. And I waited it out, waited that first week. That name didn't come up. And I thought, yeah, I can't wait any longer. I got to jump in there. And in I go. And then I sweated it out for the rest of that week to make sure that name didn't come up. And it never did.
You're going to share who that name was?
That was you, Sean. It was the legendary Shaun Aquiline. I think I can beat everybody in town, but there's one name I couldn't beat, and it was you. And when you didn't put your name in, then I'm in, and everybody else. We could have had 20 more candidates on there, and I still would have been happy.
Very good. Very good answer. You are vocal.
Yes.
You are our active armchair mayor.
Yep.
On the legacy paper.
Yep.
And you are always good at putting out. And you've always said this, it's an opinion.
Yes.
You've never said it was opinion editorial. It was an opinion. And you, to some degree, represent what some people think. Now, you've been accused of not having all the facts.
Right. Yep.
People say, well, Peter doesn't have all the facts.
Right.
Why is it that you think that people feel that way? And what is it that you represent in that?
I read social media. I talk to a lot of people on the street. So, was I digging right deep into some of those facts? Did I want to read 100 pages of a report? No, I was reading the executive summary. I was talking to the people on the street, and my opinion was everybody's opinion. So when I commented, I was commenting on what I heard and what I felt. So if I had the facts right, then great. If I didn't, well, then somebody didn't do a very good job of communicating those facts. And that would be my biggest criticism of this current council. When we get into an election, everybody comes out and throws information at you. They throw up their signs, they're throwing information at you, they're communicating with you. They're the best communicators in the world. And as soon as we elect them, we hear crickets. It goes dead quiet and we don't hear communication from them at all. So I don't know if you remember Antoinette Haberstedt. Antoinette was on council, you know, maybe 5 years ago. Antoinette would wade into the Stoke list with all the trolls there, fearless, and would get right in there. Somebody came up with bad facts. She was in there and saying, nope, I'm going to take exception to that. And I respected her for that. And unfortunately, she didn't run again because of the challenge that worked that we all get into. But I respected her for that. And nobody picked that up in new council. Nobody did that communication. So I got into that job of communication, and I challenged the politicians, and I said, you're doing this wrong, I don't agree with this, and nobody stepped up and said otherwise, so I must have been right.
If you were to be elected, what's something that you foresee for yourself to be a personal challenge?
Personal challenge is spending. The city needs to get its spending under control. So I wouldn't run the city any differently than I run my business. If you ask my staff, I'm a penny pincher. If we don't absolutely need that twist tie, we're not buying that twist tie. You know, if you're looking after your nickels, then you're looking after your dollars. The same way is with the city. If you elect me, I'm putting my hand up to object. But we're going to have budget cuts. And I'll come right out and say it now. If you don't want budget cuts, if you like the way it is now, and you don't mind 2-5% increases plus whatever sewer and water will be, then don't vote for me. Because I'll guarantee it that the bureaucrats aren't going to chase me away. When it comes to budget time, I'm putting my hand up and said, we're doing budget cuts, and we're going to hit them hard and hit them fast the first year. With anything, and the city would be a big example of this, is spending's got out of control over the years. It just, a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit there. It needs a haircut. the hair's gotten long. You can't even see the city's eyes anymore because the hair's falling down over their eyes. One of the big areas is those shiny vehicles and the fire department. The fire department's been a sacred cow over all these years, and the fire department gets what the fire department wants, and that's going to end. If we can bring spending under control, then the other things fall into line. So how do we afford to bring alternate fuels to city vehicles? We'll have flexibility. If we cut operating costs and we can come up with a reserve fund, we've got flexibility to do other things. Same with DCCs that we discussed recently. If we can cut operating costs, we know that sewer and water costs are going up. They're inevitable. But we can balance that off with lower spending on the operating side so that there's minimal impact to the taxpayer.
Do you think that once you get in and you kind of understand from city staff perspective that perhaps there's going to be times where you get body checked more than you would have thought, or you'll see things from a different perspective and go, okay, this is my opinion about it ahead of time, and now that I'm on council, I am starting to understand why we can't do that or otherwise.
You bet. You can change my mind. I mean, I'm not 100% stuck on that, but what you have to watch is the line that they're going to give you, that the fire department will give you, that your insurance rates are going to go up if we don't have a brand new fire engine. I don't think so. I'm in the trucking business too, and my oldest truck's a 1998 Kenworth. Well, as long as it runs, it can do deliveries and make me money, it's staying there. So, you know, you can't convince me otherwise, but absolutely, you can change my mind. There's areas which I don't have expertise in that the staff will be able to explain to that on more municipal things. But I don't mind bringing in outside experts to come and give us a presentation to council to maybe give me one more opinion on that, so that I just don't have that one opinion. Let's bring another one in and so I can balance the two off.
Okay, so your campaign slogan for this is let's pinch the nickel to the beaver screams.
Cut. You know, if I had to that, and same with my campaign, you won't see one sign of mine, you won't see one brochure. I'm not sending one cent on my campaign. I'm not asking for any donations. It's going to be 100% word of mouth. If you like what I'm saying, tell your friends. If you don't like what I'm saying, tell your friends to vote for somebody else. And that's the way I'm going to run it. I find signs to be wasteful, brochures to be wasteful. I don't like politicians stuffing things in my face and telling me what to do at election time. And if you go to the post office, that bin is full of garbage. And why do we do that? We don't need to do that, and I'm not going to do that. I'm going to challenge all the other candidates not to put any signs up. Let's not litter our town. Don't put signs up. You get the word out otherwise. Back to the cost-cutting thing, I'm going to cost-cut that as well.
Now, you've always been very good at being quick. That's one of your many talents.
Right.
You've expressed numerous times what council and mayor have been up to and what you don't like. In the 4 years, has there been a time where something's gone through or didn't go through, either or, that you were going, that was a good choice, I'm proud of that decision, and I would have backed them up, and I'm proud of what they did that time?
Absolutely. The McRoundabout was a success. You can put that one on the success sheet. I would have disagreed with the design on it. I was with lots of others that didn't think that would work. Overall, but for the most part, I'm happy with that roundabout. I think it was the best design that we could have done for that space, and it operates 99% of the time fluidly. There's the odd time it doesn't, but I think that was the best plan, and they did an excellent job on the roundabout.
Now, you're in the Big Eddy side of things, so water was a big topic for the last 4 years.
Yep.
Where did you stand on that?
It still annoys me to this day. It's nice that we got it out of the way, but there's two things that stink about that. The one is that they stopped development because they said, we don't have enough water, so you can't build a house there until we put a new water line in. I just didn't buy that. The other thing is the silly thing was over-designed. So back to, nobody challenged that budget process on it. If you look at the design and what our requirements are for the water system there and the size of pipe they're putting in, it's to meet industrial standards. So with that water system they put in, we can have a paint factory in the Big Eddy. Well, realistically, we're not putting a paint factory in there. And if we'd have taken the paint factory scenario out of it and restricted zoning so that you couldn't put a paint factory into light industrial, heavy industrial, we could have shrunk the size of that piping system and saved ourselves money. And nobody looked at that. Nobody would consider that.
As you've been known for being kind of quirky, funny, we've known you had Bordy out, you'd always like to shake things up. Right. Is there anything that you want anyone to know about you besides that you do have that light sense of humor, but that you do understand and perceive things in a different direction or a different way? Is there something that maybe the community doesn't know about you that you want them to know because of the funny perception that you have of yourself because you are fairly lighthearted?
No, you know, that's just the way I am. It, you know, believe it or not, I try to keep things on the positive side, even when it's a negative. I won't bring up a negative without offering a solution, because I remember Mark McKee saying that early on in his term. He wants solutions, or maybe it was Dave Raven. They want solutions. So I won't criticize anything without a solution. But no, I like to keep it light. I mean, life's short. We got to have fun while we're here. Not everybody wants to hear negativity. So, yeah, I try to keep things light. You know, when I first put the board out that time, that's exactly what's sitting in my head, is what's on that board. And it pops into my head. I stick it on the board. Don't think about it too much. I never even thought anybody was reading it until further down the pipe when the city tried to take it away. But the board will be coming back out, because I've got how many years full of gook stuck in my head that needs to get out onto that board. And I'm on Twitter, but nobody in Revelstoke looks at Twitter. So I tried to stick that stuff on Twitter, but, you know, it just goes unheard.
We're not a Twitter town.
No.
So for one final thing, is there anything that you want anyone to know? Anything that we didn't touch base on that you think it's important as we move forward for you?
Absolutely. Get out and vote. There's one thing I hate the most, is apathy. I don't see why we're not getting 80% turnout on vote. If you don't get out and vote, that means we can get certain cliques out and vote. And if you think the development community is driving the agenda, then you're not getting out and voicing your opinion. So if you've got an opinion, you need to get out and vote. And what rings that to home is when I worked for the city of Calgary, I was a QP Local 38 member, and I decided to go to a meeting one day, and there was only 10 of us at the meeting. And I realized that I could gather up a handful of my friends and buy them dinner, and we could go down to a meeting, and I could have controlled the entire agenda of that large union that we had going on there, because apathy and nobody came out to vote or even cared about the process.
That's a good thought to have, and I think, you know what, everyone that's running is going to all be on the same board in that regard.
You bet.
Get out and vote. Well, thanks, Peter, for coming in. And we will have Tony Morobito in tomorrow at the same time. And Cody will be in on Friday at 8:40. Thanks, Peter.
Yep.